Okay, we're going to have a look at drilling and hole making. So here's just a little clip of drilling action. I'm sure you've seen drilling happen before. This is a twist drill. And you can see it's accumulating this sort of spiral chip as it goes in. We'll talk a little bit more about what's going on there in the lecture here. All right, so drilling is a very common process. I've seen it said that almost half of the chips that get made in metalworking come from chips from drilling. There are two different ways to use a drill bit. You can rotate the drill or rotate the workpiece. So you may have, if you're in my class and you did the lab, one of the first things you did on the lathe was chuck up a piece of aluminum, turn it on, and drill it out. You used a center drill on it to drill the end out. You held the drill bit stationary and you rotated the work. So it works both ways. Drilling is a little bit problematic because it's happening far away from the place where you're holding the tool. You're holding it way back at the end of the shank on the tool, and the cutting is happening at the complete other end. So number one, you've got the drill's going to actually twist some, and you get deflection, because remember that that formula that we looked at earlier, that is this one, this formula here says that, you know, if you're holding the tool way back here at this end and you apply any kind of force out here, it's the length is what really matters. The deflection happens at the third power of the length. And so this is one of these what I call intrinsically unstable processes, where you, by necessity of the process, you have to hold the tool far away from where the cutting actually happens. And so that can be problematic. The other thing is that this is happening, the drilling operation is happening at the bottom of a hole. So you're way down here at the bottom of this hole, you're far away from the coolant. You're trying to get coolant down in here. I guess we talked earlier in the milling or in the cutting fluids lecture, we said that you can get drill bits that have coolant passages where you pump the coolant all the way down the tool and then it flows out of these flutes here. But that's, you know, that's a little bit expensive and that's a little bit more uncommon. But you're going to have typically this difficulty of getting the cutting fluid all the way down into to where the cutting is actually happening, down at the bottom of this hole. So drilling is kind of problematic for these reasons. So there are different types of drilling tools and different methods that we'll look at, and these are going to depend on these sorts of things: the diameter of the hole, the depth of the hole, and the ratio of those two to each other, the tolerance required, and whether you need to make a lot of holes or just a few holes, and then the material type and conditions. So drilling is only one way to make a hole. There are a lot of other ways, sometimes a real easy way. Like if you have sheet metal, it's much easier to punch a hole than it is to drill a hole, for instance. All right, just a little bit of terminology. You should be familiar with these three types of holes. That is a through hole, obviously goes through the material. A blind hole is one that goes partially through the material, but it has a depth to it. I should mention that when you're talking about the depth of a hole, the depth of a hole is the depth of the cylindrical part of the hole. It does not include the little tip angle down here. So the depth of a hole is that depth. It is the depth where the cylinder goes down. It does not include the tip. So if you see a hole that's referenced half an inch deep, then that is the depth, not of the tip, but of the cylindrical part of the hole. So a blind hole will have a depth. Then there's an interrupted hole, and that's a hole that intersects with another hole. And this kind of hole can cause difficulty. We'll look at some other sort of difficult conditions for drilling. But this is one of them, because when you have two holes that intersect like this, you have an imbalance in the cutting forces on the end of the drill. And for the reasons that I just talked about, you know, you're holding the drill far away, that can cause trouble, because then you get a lot of deflection in the drill bit. You get a lot of the bits wanting to twist and sort of to warp out of the way. So interrupted hole can cause problems like that. Short hole drilling, that is holes that have a short depth to diameter ratio, can be drilled in one motion. When you start to get deeper holes, and this, this is just kind of a reference. Sometimes, and it depends somewhat on the material as well, and that is how far you can go down without having to pull the drill bit out and drag the chips out. So, but this is kind of a good rule of thumb. Three or four diameters would be a, and I like to err on the side. I'll try never to drill more than three diameters in one go. Unless I'm doing it manually. If I'm on the lathe and I can see the chips flowing out evenly and that there's no chance that the chips are backing up, then I'll just keep going. But that is an exception. But anyway, three to four diameters for drill bits up to an inch, and then 2.5 diameters for really large drill bits. So when you're drilling deeper holes, you have to you can't do it in one go. That is unless you have through the spindle coolant, but we're just going to say that we don't have that that option. All right. So what you wind up using is a process called peck drilling. So peck drilling is when you drill down and then you bring the drill out to drag the chips out of the bottom of the hole, and then the chips will generally fall off of the drill, hopefully, and then you go back down into the hole and drill another depth. So my rule of thumb for this, and again, this depends on the material somewhat, but my incremental peck drilling rule of thumb is three diameters for the first peck, and then two more diameters for the second peck, and then one diameter until you get to the depth that you're trying to reach. Okay, so I'll just, this is a little video I did several years ago, but I'll just come through here. This kind of gives a nice general procedure. Okay, this is a center drill. You should know that there's actually a tool called a spot drill that does this spot drilling operation a little better than a center drill will. And I'm pretty unhappy. You know, I was probably concentrating more on getting the shot than making a good hole. This is not a great spot even for spot drilling, but we'll talk about why that is, and we'll look at spot drilling in a little bit more detail. But generally, even though I'm using a center drill to do it, generally the first operation is to go in and do a spot drilling operation. And what that does is that positions the hole very nicely. You see, the reason that we would use something like a center drill as a spot drill, and like I said, that's a second choice, really. The best tool to use is a spot drill. I just didn't have one handy that day. But the reason you use a spot drill or spot drill with a center drill is because they're very short, stubby drill bits, and they won't deflect very much. I'm going to refer once again to that length and deflection equation. They don't flex. And so you make a little spot where you want the hole to go. And that's, if you've ever tried to drill a medium-sized hole in steel with a hand drill, then you'll know that that drill bit's going to want to walk all over the surface. And even though you've got this mounted in a milling machine or in a drill press, the drill will still want to walk around a little bit before it starts drilling, and that will wind up in a poorly positioned hole. And so that's why you would use the spot drill for that. And like I said, we're going to talk a little bit more about that later, good spot drilling and bad spot drilling, which is what that is. All right, so here we go. We're drilling down and pulling the drill bit out of the hole to pull the chips out. And then the chips, like I said, you hope the chips will break off when it comes out of the hole. A lot of times they break off as you go back in, which is actually what's happening here. It's kind of hard to see in the video, but as I'm going back in, the chips are shedding off of the bit pretty easily. And again, like I said, this is the depth of the hole. It's the depth of this cylindrical portion there. All right, some things to keep in mind. I don't think I've mentioned it right now. I guess I'll talk about it in a few minutes. But it's important to understand that twist drilling is really just a roughing operation. It is hard to keep deep holes straight, and there are better drill bits. If you need to make a lot of really deep holes, there are better ways of doing that. And we'll talk about gun drilling which is a pretty good way to do that if you have the equipment to do it. But here's a twist drill. It is probably the most familiar, really metal cutting tool to a lot of folks. You know, there's drill bits, twist drills, a hacksaw is probably the other tool that most everybody's used to cut metals in one way or another. But anyway, twist drills can be made of high-speed steel, or you can, or various high-speed steels. You can get the cobalt high-speed steel. Lots of different coatings. The most common coatings are the black oxide, which is actually a layer of magnetite that's built up on the surface of the drill, which is a good coating in that it's inexpensive, and it is slightly porous, and it allows lubricating oil to penetrate the surface and protect the drill bit. A really good one, though, is this gold-colored stuff that's on there. It's called titanium nitride, and titanium nitride does a really good job for two reasons. And number one is it's a very hard coating, and that allows the drill bit, extends the drill bit life significantly because you have this much, much harder material than high-speed steel that's actually in contact with the metal. And number two, it has a really good coefficient of friction, so really good tribological properties or friction properties that allow the chips to slide and move their way out of the drill more easily. We'll look at some other types of drills. Indexable insert drills are available, and we'll see some of those. All right, so here's a little bit about twist drill geometry. All right, so kind of going from my illustration there, this is considered the shank of the drill bit. The shank is what actually goes into the work-holding device. One of the most common work-holding devices that I probably have slides on later is a Jacobs chuck. So you can get these twist drills in a couple of configurations. One has three flats around it, so it's a little less prone to spinning around. You can also get tapered drill bits that go into a Morse taper like you would have in the tailstock of a lathe or in this sometimes in the spindle of a drill press. Probably the most recognizable feature of the drill are the flutes. You've got these fluted cut passageways down the length of the drill bit, and those are the passageway that the chips get forced out of the hole through the flutes. The margin of the drill press is this unground surface around the outside of the drill bit. So the drill bit has mostly been ground down on these what are called the lands. It's been ground to give some clearance around the hole. So as this drill bit goes in and drills a hole, the part that's actually in contact with the hole is just the margin. Okay, so just this little band of unground material around the outside of the drill bit. Let's see. All right, the helix angle is the angle of this helix. I'll just drop back to my slide. Here you can see where the helix angle is the angle from the axis of the drill. And there you can see the helix in action. So that's the amount of twist that you have in the twist drill itself, is that helix angle. All right, and then the land is the part that's not the flute. It's the solid part around the outside of the drill bit. Okay, then down here at the tip of the drill bit, this is pretty important. This edge across here is called the chisel edge, and the chisel edge is not really a very good cutting edge at all. Okay, the actual cutting on the drill bit happens on these. These are the cutting lips. Okay, so let me just get rid of that chisel edge right there. Those two spots right there, and just a little tiniest bit of the margin here at the edge, just one feed revolution of the edge right here, is what actually does the cutting. The chisel edge at the very tip of the drill, very terrible cutting surface. It's as you can see here, it's laid. It has a very, very extremely negative rake angle, so it does a terrible job of cutting. It just kind of rocks back and forth across the surface there. So that chisel edge, just this little bit right here, can cause trouble. Okay, because of the fact that it's not a very good cutting edge. So where it comes from is the fact that when you grind the drill bit, you grind the end of the drill bit. It's not just a cone shape at the end of the drill. It is a cone that is at an angle. Okay, so that cone is actually off center from the drill bit itself. And that one's not doing a very good job of it. Let me see here. All right, yeah, that's the one. So that cone is off center from the axis of the cutter in two different directions. And the reason that it's done this way, so the cone itself, let me see if I can zoom in on it here. All right, so it's not centered in any direction. What that shape is doing is it's creating the clearance behind the drill bit. So as the drill bit does its cutting, as it moves in and cuts with this cutting lip, the section behind that cutting lip on the point there has got to drop out of the way. So you've got to have clearance between this and the metal. This should not be contacting the bottom of the hole at all. It should only be this chisel tip, the cutting lip that's contacting the bottom of the hole. This surface needs to have clearance. It needs to get out of the way and not make contact with the metal. That's what that cone shape is doing. And the cone shape is designed so that this drops away. Okay. And so you can see maybe a little bit there how you have clearance. So as this thing rotates, all of this moves out of the way and does not touch the machined surface that the hole of the hole that's being made. The chisel edge is just the intersection of those two cone shapes. So the two cones come together, they intersect at that chisel shape. It is not ground in there. Okay. Now you will see drill bits where you do some thinning on this. You actually grind in and narrow down some of that chisel edge and provide a little bit better cutting. So we'll talk, maybe it's a good time now. All right, so what you do in order to get a drill to go in nicely is you drill a hole that is about the width of that chisel edge, about the width or the diameter of what's called the core of the drill or the web. So let me try to show you that. So anyway, this is a hole that's been drilled out to make way for that to move the metal so that the chisel edge does not have to try to do any cutting. And so when we try to cut with this drill bit, we're going to start by cutting in here close to the inside of the drill. Okay, so we're going to be up here close to this web or core. Let me show you that where that idea of the core comes from. Okay, if we take our drill bit and we section it, and just take a look at the contours of the drill bit. If we go and just slice through it and we look every fraction of an inch or so along the length of our drill bit, if we look at the end, you'll see that there's part of the drill bit that never gets ground away, and that is the web or the core of the drill. So that is the diameter that we would want to make our pilot hole. Because that a hole of this diameter, notice that's the thickness across here. This is called the web of the drill. If we look at it longitudinally, then that's the core of the drill. But that is the size of the pilot drill that we would want to drill to move that material out of the way of the drill bit. All right, so that would mean a hole roughly this size would get us a hole that would clear the way for the chisel edge, and that would be our pilot hole. While I've got this up, let me talk a little bit about doing a center drill. Okay, actually I lied. Before I talk about the spot drilling, I want to talk about something that's happening here at the tip of the drill bit. So I'm going to section through the drill bit every few thousandths of an inch. I'm going to spin the drill bit around a little bit. Let me get that back on. All right, so we're going to chop through the drill bit every few thousandths of an inch there. And then I'm going to turn this so we can look at the rake angle of the drill bit. Okay, so these lines here in close, these are going to show us the rake angle of the drill. There we go, very close to the center, and you can see that we have a very, very almost neutral rake angle going on there. Okay, so in here close we have a very, very neutral rake angle, But as we move further out to the edges of the drill bit, out here, these lines you see are tipped further back. That means a more and more aggressive rake angle towards the outside of the drill bit. So out here at this edge of the drill bit, as we move away from the center, we have a more and more aggressive rake angle. You see how these lines are tipped further back? That means they're trying to bite in. Okay, so let me get out of that. All right, so when we before I talk about center drilling, let me talk about making a hole larger. So we said if we want to drill a pilot, we want to try to make the pilot the diameter of the core of the drill. Okay, so you might think, well, maybe if I drilled a bigger pilot, that would do even better. Okay, and in fact, I've seen in a magazine that was not a machining magazine, like a woodworking magazine, they said, you know, the thing to do if you want to drill a large hole is you start with a small hole and then you make a little bit bigger hole and a little bit bigger hole. Well, that's not the thing to do, and let me show you why. It's better to start with a small hole where you've got the really neutral rake angle happening against the edge of the hole. As the hole gets larger, let me just change this pilot to a larger pilot diameter. All right, so now we have a wider diameter hole, and what that means is this is going to when the drill starts cutting, it's not going to be cutting towards the center where the rake angle is very small. Okay, it's going to start cutting out here at the edge. Okay, so the edge, the rake angle at that point on the drill is really sharp, and what's trying to do is the material is going to try to gouge in and grab that material. The drill is going to try to grab onto that edge, and you may have had this experience before if you've tried to increase the diameter of a hole. Maybe you had a hole that was drilled undersized and you tried to go back with another drill bit and make it a little bit larger, and you get this kind of action where you go in, you gouge in. So the moral of the story is that drill bits want to start cutting in here close to the core. You want to start using, start making chips in here at this point where the rake angle is very, very neutral. And it kind of drags the material and centers the drill, and then as it moves in, it starts cutting more and more on its way out. Okay, so like I said, what you want to do is you want to drill a spot first of all. Okay, so it's important that the spot drill have a wider point tip angle than the drill does. And here's why. When you start drilling, you want the contact to be down here at the bottom of the hole, towards the center of the drill bit. Okay, so out here where the rake angle is extremely positive and aggressive, we're not making contact. Instead, we're making contact in here towards the center of the drill let me just light that up. So you're making contact in here where the rake angle is neutral and you have good alignment with the hole. If you were to start out here, you'd have that problem that I was talking about when you're trying to drill and enlarge a hole. So you want to make sure if you're spot drilling that you spot drill, that the spot drill has a tip angle that's broader, that's more open, that's larger than the tip angle of the drill bit itself. All right, so speaking of the point angle, that is the angle that the drill bit makes. That is this angle down here at the tip, this included angle at the tip. That angle typically is 118 degrees, but let me grab my slides. But it can, that's 118 degrees is kind of a nice general purpose angle. But you can see there's some cases where you want a more pointy drill bit, like for gray cast iron. Sometimes you want a little bit larger angle for some of these materials, really tough materials like Inconel and Hastelloy. All right, so, but like I said, 118 degrees is kind of your general purpose drill bit. I kind of skimmed past this slide about the shank. This is a Jacobs chuck. All right, so these chucks can be keyed chucks. You can also have keyless chucks, which do a little bit better job in my opinion, but a keyed chuck, most people are familiar with. You put a little key in here and you turn it and tighten down. These should be used exclusively with drill bits. You do not try to hold things like end mills with these chucks. You should know that a lot of these have a taper in the back of them, which is a JT taper, a Jacobs taper in the back. It's a real short taper, but it's a short and kind of flat taper. It's kind of like a Morse taper in that it will self-lock. When you assemble two pieces together with a Jacobs taper, they will lock together. And to remove a drill bit like this, you can't just pull it off. You need to use these drill wedges, chuck wedges, to remove those chucks. Not all chucks are installed with a tapered. Some have threaded interface. All right, so drill sizes, you should know, are available in sort of standard sizes. Okay, so first of all, you can get all of the fractional sizes. That is, if you have a number that tends to appear on a ruler, like a 16th or an 1/8 or a 1/4 inch, you can get drill sizes in those fractional sizes. Then there are also number and letter sizes of the drills. So the number sizes are down here, kind of the smaller sizes that fill in between the fractions. And this is based on a preferred number series. So they're pretty well standardized. You have like a number 39 or a number 40 drill bit. You can also have letter sizes, and those kind of fill in the blanks between the 1/4 inch size or so. They fill in between the fractional sizes. You can also get metric drills. I don't see it on this size, but when we're talking about twist drills, you can get twist drills in a couple of different sizes. The two most popular are jobber drills. These are jobber length drills, and another size is a screw machine length. And I kind of like the screw machine length if you don't have to drill very deep holes, because they're shorter drill bits. And like we talked about before, a shorter drill bit is a more rigid drill bit. Let's see. Oh, another thing to know is that you can get drill rod in the sizes of any size you can buy a drill in. You can get drill rod in those sizes, and the drill rod's available in different types of tool steel, and it's a real economical way, especially if you're buying like 01, a real economical way to buy tool steel. Let's see, the twist drilling, I've already talked a little bit about this, and the fact that the rake angle toward the center of the drill is a lot less aggressive than the rake angle outside the drill. This little Sandvik video is a pretty good look at the chip formation action, and he points out that there's actually three different regions where you have three different types of chip behavior. That is, when you're entering the hole, you get one type of chip behavior, and then when you're down below the surface, you get another, and then as you exit the hole, you get yet another type of chip formation. But that's more of a tool design topic than a drilling topic. This is just for fun. This is drilling some cast iron, and you can see that it's, as far as cast iron goes, that's a little bit ductile. Okay, so it may be maybe some kind of ductile iron. You just get these chips breaking off real easily. And like I said, if I'm on the lathe or on a machine and I see the chips coming out really easily like this, without jamming up, that one's starting to kind of back up a little bit. That might give me pause and want to come out and clean that out. But if the chips are coming out nicely, I just keep going. This is just FYI. You can get drill bits with renewable cutting tips. Okay, so this is a tungsten carbide insert that gets installed on this drill bit, and instead of having to sharpen the drill, you can just replace the tip. We did talk a little bit about center drilling and spot drilling. This is a spot drill. All right, so this is designed to do the job of drilling a starting location for a hole. A center drill has a different purpose in life. Although they are very commonly used for spot drilling, they're really designed to drill this 60-degree angle, usually 60-degree angle, in the end of material to be held in a live center. If you are going to use a spot drill or a center drill to do spot drilling, you want to make sure that you're only using the very tip of the pilot here, and that you don't go even as far as the cylindrical part of the pilot. You want to be in here on the tip, But really, the best tool for the job is a spot drill and not a center drill. But in a pinch, you know. All right, so then there is some other special hole geometry that we'll talk about. We talked about that's a blind hole. This is a counterbored hole. There are counterboring tools that will make this shape. A lot of them have pilots because typically, the pilot on the end of the counterboring tool will guide this the formation of this nice square bored out section. These are typically used with socket head cap screws. You know, these things. Okay, so those are socket head cap screws. This is a countersunk hole or countersink in a hole. Okay, and these are used with flathead cap screws or flathead fasteners. There are different included angles for countersinks, but 82 degrees and 90 degree countersink, those are pretty common. Spot facing. I don't have a good picture. Let me do some spot facing for you. Okay, so let's say that we have this casting right here, and this casting has this tapered surface on there. And let's just say that I'm going to come in here and try to drill this out. Number one, that might be a little bit dicey because the drill is going to want to drift down. But let's just say that I've gone in here and I've drilled this hole out. And then I want to put a flat washer on the top of this surface here. Okay, so let's say we have this bolt in here like this, and that bolt we want to tighten up, but that bolt's not going to do very well if it contacts here on the side, okay? Maybe you can see that's just not a very nice way to load a bolt. It's going to make tightening this thing kind of an issue. And so what spot facing does is it'll come in here and just machine out a nice flat surface on the material for our fastener to then sit down on. Okay, so we'll put a washer in there, and then this is going to allow that fastener to come in here and sit nice and flush against that surface. Okay, so this is a spot face. All right, then a chamfer. We talked a little bit about chamfering when we looked at threaded fasteners. A countersink is kind of like a really, really large chamfer. If you were to just go in here and kind of break this edge, that would be a chamfer. And then, of course, tapered holes like you would see for tapered end mills and things like that. There are different ways of making tapered holes. We talk about that more. We actually do some of that in 3421, the Processes 2 class. But you can set up on a lathe and turn tapered holes. There are tapering attachments for some lathes. And you can also make a tapered hole with a tapered reamer. We'll talk about reamers here in a little bit. There are some other types of drill bits, pilot drills, spade drills are kind of flat drills. Usually you think of spade drills for drilling wood, but there are spade drills for metal cutting. Subland drills are similar to step drills. Step drills have multiple diameters, so when you drill with a step drill, you can get multiple diameters built into the drill. I need to get some pictures of some step drills. I've got some downstairs, but a subland drill is a type of step drill. It's really just designed to be easier to resharpen than a step drill. And a multi-step drill, you may have seen a lot of electricians use these to drill holes in sheet metal. They allow you to drill multiple diameters with the same tool. Then gun drills, we'll talk about gun drilling and we'll talk about trepanning here in just a second. Well, I guess here's a gun drill. Okay, so gun drilling is a great way to drill really, really deep holes, holes with a very large length to diameter ratio. So these are holes that are many, many, many diameters deep. They have a different cutting action than a typical twist drill does. Also, they're used with a bushing to hold them straight, and they all have through the spindle coolant. So all of these flush coolant down this spindle and out the out along this single flute. Sometimes two flutes, sometimes a single flute. The drill tip geometry you can see here is completely different from a twist drill, and it's got a very wide, I guess what's equivalent to the margin, where this kind of acts as a guide, and you can get really nicely machined holes. We talked about twist drilling kind of being a roughing operation, but gun drilling is not like twist drilling. It produces a very nice hole. This Eldorado tool has got a really nice series on gun drills, and I really recommend that you watch some of their stuff. This first little video is just a really quick 2 minute video, but they have a series that's really excellent on gun drilling, so I would recommend you look that up. Then trepanning is a way to drill a hole, and this is a pretty nice logical thing, because if you're trepanning, what you're doing normally when you drill a hole, you turn everything inside that hole into chips. Well, sometimes you just need a through hole. Like, let's say that you were laser cutting out a hole or something. It's possible to just remove a band or an annulus of material and then have the complete hole. And that's what trepanning is all about. Okay, so there's some trepanning videos. I've got some links to some on the website or on the lectures there. But this is, he's trepanning with this tool that has just a single or maybe two cutters in it. There's the little cutter right there. And so you can see, instead of turning all the inside of this shaft into chips, they're just cutting away a core, okay? And sometimes you'll hear the term core stay drilling used. And there are the chips coming out. So instead of turning, 6 or 8 inches of diameter into chips, you're just turning this round section into chips. Then there are other various types of drilling. This is one that I saw at a trade show a few years ago. I thought it was pretty neat. It's just kind of on the side, but that makes a really nice hole that can then be tapped. That's a form tap, by the way. And so that's just kind of unique. All right, so there are different cutting speeds and feeds that you would use for drill bits. These you'd want to look up on a table. The real moral of the story, though, is this, okay? It's easy to burn up a drill bit. So, first of all, make sure you know what you're doing. And I'm talking to you guys that are going to be in my class, and you're going to be downstairs machining, and you're going to be more or less doing things a little bit less supervised. If I give you a great big drill bit, chances are, number one, that I wrote in red somewhere on the place where you got it what the recommended RPM is. Don't be a dumbass and run that thing at any other RPM, okay? I'm going to tell you what RPM to run the drill bit at. If you don't know, then ask, okay? So this is the moral of the story. It is easy to burn up a drill bit. Don't do it, okay? I hate to sound angry, but they're just some real bonehead moves, and I'm telling you right now, don't make this bonehead move, okay? It's one that can be avoided. All right, now there are other ways to improve a hole geometry. Remember that we said that twist drilling is it's a roughing operation, and to get a really nice high-quality hole, these holes require some kind of a finishing operation. Reamers are the easiest way to do that. Okay, so a reamer is a multiple tooth cutter. They can be straight or helical flutes on reamers, but they have a series of cutters around them. And they are only designed to remove a few thousandths of stock. You don't drill with a reamer, you just clean a hole up. So that reamer is going to come in and make a real nice consistent cut around the outside of its circumference. It'll clean up and make a hole much rounder. It will give it a much nicer surface finish, but it won't improve a hole's location at all. All right, there's a look at some reaming stuff. This is a reamer in action here. So there's a reamer. You can see it has multiple teeth on it. And, there shouldn't be a lot of material removed. It should just go in and kind of clean up the hole. Here are some recommended roughing and finishing reaming stock removal recommendations. Then there is boring. So we looked at boring on a lathe. You can also do the same type of operation on a mill. So that looks just like a boring bar that you might use in a lathe. But in this case, the bar itself is spinning around, and you're going to feed this into a hole. This allows you to take a twist drilled hole and clean it up and get a better surface finish and get better roundness. And you can also, if it's not too far out of position, you can improve the position of a hole with a boring operation. All right, so I think we said that. Another thing you can do to improve the hole's characteristics is a burnishing operation. So burnishing is basically just dragging a roller across the surface, and what that does is it lays flat any of these surface asperities, and you can wind up with a real nice mirror finish on the inside of a hole. So this is done a lot for like hydraulic cylinders, things like that, that need a really nice round hole with excellent surface characteristics. So in terms of machines for hole making, obviously there is the drill press. Now, the drill press that you're probably familiar with is known as a sensitive drill press. So the sensitive drill press is one that has a feed handle on it, where you feed with your own strength and you feel how much that drill is engaging. Okay, how much the feed pressure is. So a typical drill press that you just your generic garden variety drill press, like the one that you used in the lab to start the die on your threading operation. We were using a drill press for that. That's a sensitive drill press. A radial drill. Here's a this is a little video of a pretty large radial drill. Okay, so that's a pretty common type of drill, drilling machine for larger purposes. Radial drills tend to be strictly for larger stuff. Then you can have machines that have multiple spindles. You can gang holes together, drill multiple holes simultaneously, and things like that. Obviously, you can use a milling machine to drill. Before the illness thing, a lot of you guys have already used the milling machine to drill with, and you use the sensitive quill feed on the milling machine to drill. I think I said that right. I don't know. You can also use lathes to drill as well. And then there's other specialty equipment. This is a tool that's designed to process structural steel. So it has multiple spindles and can work in multiple axes simultaneously. So there's some specialized drilling equipment out there. All right, you need to be familiar with each of these processes. What's that look like? So that's twist drilling, and he's drilling a blind hole. This is a boring operation. C and D are both reamers. This is a counter-boring operation. You can see the little pilot on the end of the counter-boring tool. F is spot facing. This is a counter-sinking operation. And like I was saying, if this is done just to a very small amount, then it would be a chamfering operation. Same kind of schematic, but it's just a question of size. And then this obviously is a tapping operation. And there are videos for some of those down here in the slides. All right. So that's about all we've got for drilling and hole making, and we'll see you next time.